Bike lanes, public transport and roads. If you thought the debate over transport policy in New Zealand was fraught, you can only imagine the kinds of pressures at play in one of the world's busiest cities. Janette Sadik Khan is New York's former transport commissioner and is currently working for Bloomberg Philanthropies. She headed the expansion of cycling networks in the city and famously pedestrianised a large part of Times Square. I sat down with her on Friday.
I'm not sure if you're aware, but New Zealand now has the highest level of car ownership per capita in the entire world. So welcome.
Well, thank you. That's not an honour that people are aspiring to these days.
Give us a big picture perspective, if you can, to kick things off. Globally, to what extent are cities changing from car-centric designs?
You're seeing a huge movement in cities that are moving from car-centric design to people-focused design, literally flipping the script of the street. And instead of having cars at the top of the mobility hierarchy, you're putting people at the top. And you're seeing this in city after city. World-class cities are prioritizing walking and biking and public transport because they're better for everyone. They're safer ways of getting around. They're more cost-effective ways of getting around. They improve the livability and the economic development of a city. And so you really can't afford not to be making these investments for a 21st century city.
Is it a luxury afforded only to wealthy countries, though?
These kinds of changes are incredibly inexpensive. You know, in New York, we got a lot of criticism. We had closed Times Square to cars and opened it to people. We built 650 kilometers of bike lanes, 70 plazas, 7 rapid bus lines, all under Mike Bloomberg in 6 years. People were like, you're spending all this money. That money was less than 1% of our capital budget. 99% was spent on improving our road and bridge infrastructure. But even though that was 1% of the budget, it got 99% of the headlines because we were changing the status quo.
Yeah. Can you give us a bit more of the New York story? Let's start off with the decision to pedestrianize parts of Times Square.
Well, it was a great moment. You know, I do remember going to City Hall and presenting it to Mike Bloomberg. And he had all of his deputy mayors around the table. And he asked each of them what they thought of this idea. And person after person after person, let's just say, didn't think it was a great idea, particularly since it was right before his reelection. Mm. When we were finished, I thought, okay, well, that's too bad. It would have been a great idea. But the mayor turned to me and he said, you know, I don't ask my commissioners to do the right thing according to the political calendar. I asked my commissioners to do the right thing, period. Mm. And so he shook my hand and he said, let's do it. And what let's do it meant was basically closing Broadway from 42nd to 47th Street. You know, you've been to New York City and Manhattan is on a grid, right? And Broadway is the only street that cuts through. And so it does great things, there are great plazas, but it creates these hot spots of congestion. So the idea was, let's just restore the grid so we could make it actually better for traffic because you're going through two intersections instead of, you know, three intersections. And so we did it. We did it as a pilot. So we were going to measure it and see if it worked. And if it worked, we'd keep it. And if not, we'd put it back. But doing it as a pilot, and this is a really important piece that we've seen other cities use, doing a pilot reduces the anxiety because it's temporary materials, right? It's paint, it's planters, it's stones. Right, you can put it back if it doesn't work.
Yeah.
So we did it, and it was a huge success. It was much better for business. Retail sales soared. It became one of the top 10 retail locations on the planet, and it was better for people. We had 100,000 more people going through Times Square every day. You probably saw those 100,000 additional people when you were there. But it became this model of how you can move fast to change your streets and change your city.
What did you love about bike lanes?
I think if you want to change your city, there's no better way to start than with a bike lane. And it transforms the street. And it's not just about making a street better for cyclists. When you put down a bike lane, you make a street better for everyone. You can shorten the crossing, which makes it easier for kids to cross the street, for older people to cross the street. You can improve the lanes for drivers. And it's easy to create this new space for cyclists. So the street's safer. It feels better. And when you have more people on the street, people naturally kind of slow down and accommodate everybody. And when you think about it, you know, the great streets, You know, in cities that you see today, what do you love about them? They're filled with people, right? London, Paris, Rome, you know, all these, Barcelona, Bogota, all of these places, Mexico City, they're great cities because they have great streets that are filled with people. And so that's the sort of secret sauce of cities.
You mentioned the opposition you had to the pedestrianisation plan in Times Square. What kind of opposition did you have for 650 Ks of bike lanes in New York?
Yeah, it was certainly a street fight, you know. There are 8.4 million New Yorkers, and I started to feel that there were 8.4 million traffic engineers because everybody had a really strong opinion about it. But the interesting thing was, you know, when you move fast and you show what's possible on your streets, right, people are not used to their streets changing. So I understand the anger, right, because people are used to, this is the way my street has been, and if that's the way it's been, suddenly somebody coming in and changing it is upsetting. It's, you know, you're concerned about it, you're fearful about it. But when you can show how the street can change, you know, it's amazing how the proof of the project changes how people feel about the streets. So we had a lot of people that came out and demonstrated. Yeah. Some of my favorite signs were like, don't be conned by Sadik Khan. You know, I mean, they had like very strong wordplay and a lot of strong feelings about the work. But the interesting piece was after those 650 kilometers of bike lanes were put down and after the bike lash that we went through, the last poll taken by the New York Times at the end of the Bloomberg administration found 73% support for bike share.
Yeah.
You know, 72% support for our plazas and 64% support for our bike lanes. Mm. You know, if bike lanes were running for mayor, they would have been elected. Mm. And that's a very different status quo than it was when we started. And so you can actually change the culture and what people's expectations and experience is of their city.
Okay. I put it to you, though, that New York is different to New Zealand in that, first of all, it's very flat. There is a lot of high-density housing. There is an amazing public transport network with a subway that runs 24/7. Is a city like New York uniquely suited to bike lanes in a way that perhaps countries like New Zealand aren't quite as well suited?
It's so funny because there's always that universal objection, you know? And they even used it in New York City. It's like, why are you doing this? We're not Amsterdam. We're not Copenhagen. You know, we're too hot in the summer. We're too cold in the winter. You know, this is not going to work. Or here, it's too hilly. It's too windy. It's too cold. It's always too something, right? But what we've seen in city after city is that it's not too anything. There's no bad, you know, city for cycling. There's just bad infrastructure. And if you build it, they will come.
In your current role, you travel the world and advise mayors around the world on transport design in their cities. What are the most common problems you still see?
Well, I think it's about making choices better for people for how they get around, sort of inviting them to get around the city differently. Because, you know, if you just keep building more and more roads and more lanes, you're just going to get more and more traffic, more and more lanes filled with traffic. I mean, we've learned this lesson. That if you building more lanes to accommodate traffic is like loosening your belt to accommodate obesity, right? It doesn't work. And so you have to bring a different model. We're not going to accommodate the 30% growth that we're going to be seeing here in this city by double-decking our roads, right? By the same token, we're not going to get people onto bikes and buses and walking by wishing them onto them. We have to provide high-quality infrastructure for them to get around, easier ways for them to get around, to invite them to get around differently.
So talk to us a bit more about what you see the priorities for New Zealand as being, or the opportunities perhaps. You've been in Wellington and Auckland. What do you make of New Zealand?
Well, I think it's one of the most beautiful countries I've ever seen, and I feel very fortunate to be here. And actually, it's changed a lot. I was here 10 years ago in 2014 in Auckland, and since then, you know, I was riding bikes around with an amazing group of people yesterday, and we're riding on Key Street, and we're riding on Queen Street, and, you know, we're on K Road, and it's, you know, the light path, you know, the pink path. It was amazing.
Yeah.
You know, that infrastructure was not there 10 years ago. So a lot of progress has been made, and it's exciting to see the kind of investments that are being made on the walking and biking side. And they're the most sustainable, economic development strategies we can have. So I think that is the recipe, you know, building more and more of that in the years to come that's going to ensure that Auckland continues to be this bright light on the global map.
Like lots of other places, there is an ongoing debate about where future investment should go into new roads or into new bike lanes, into new public transport. Do you think at the moment New Zealand has the balance right?
I think that you need to be prioritizing transit and walking and biking. And I think you're seeing that in city after city. You can look, Paris is a great example of that right now. I mean, Anne Hidalgo has just doubled down on the cycling network and doubled the public transit investment, and you're seeing huge results. And I think that that's basically what it's about. And these strategies, you know, walking and biking and transit, these aren't just like amenities that are nice to have, right? These are strong economic development strategies, because when you think about it, people can move anywhere these days in this global world, right? And so people are attracted to places where it's easier to get around, where it's more livable, more enjoyable. And I think that's why these kinds of investments are so much more than just nice things to have. They're critical strategies.
From a political perspective then, what would be your advice on overcoming some of the opposition to things like more transit options or pedestrian and bike lane options?
Well, I think you have to keep going, right? I mean, I think that you're seeing other places moving forward faster, right? And so if we want to continue to have the quality of life that we have in Auckland, those are, it's critical that we make those kinds of investments. And they're not expensive, right? You can move fast to change your streets. You can move fast to change your cities. And in fact, there's a cost of just sticking with the status quo.
But is there any advice you would have from your experience in overcoming the political opposition?
I think it's really important to talk about the benefits of these kinds of strategies. Like, safety is a really important backbone for these kinds of this kind of work. And it was the frame that we used in New York City. Every project that we did, we looked at from a safety perspective. We had done this big study which looked at 7,000 traffic crashes and injuries. Like, where did they happen? Who did they happen? When did they happen? All of that. And that drove what we did. And I think that's important here, too. When you think about it, New Zealand has a higher rate of traffic fatalities than we've got in New York City. We have 3 million more people, but we have a third of the traffic fatalities that you have. And that's, you know, that's almost irresponsible. You know, you need to be prioritizing people when you're doing your streets. I was walking, you know, across the street, even just coming over here today, and there's not enough time almost across the street. You practically have to be an Olympic sprinter to get across the street. Right, and that's not great. I mean, we're in good shape, but like, if you're holding the hand of a three-year-old, or you're with an older person, it's hard to get across the street in the time that you're given. And so I think
you mean at the crossing with the lights, right?
At the crossing with the lights, and I think it's important that we—that's part of looking at our streets a little differently. And that frame, that safety frame, making it possible for everyone, not just looking at our infrastructure from the dashboard of a car. Is key.
Yeah. What do you think of congestion charging?
I'm very supportive of congestion pricing. We did that, and we proposed it under Mike Bloomberg starting in 2007, and now we're looking to implement it this summer. So it's taken a little while for us to get there. Other cities have done a great job of it. You see what Mayor Khan is doing in London with the ultra-low emission zone. You see what Mayor Saul is doing in Milan. You see, you know, so many cities are moving forward because they understand that, you know, it's hard to just keep passing the hat for funding for public transportation, and having dedicated revenue streams is really key. And it's also key because when you think about it, you were in New York City, so you saw how people got around, right? 85% of people in New York City get around by public transit, by walking and biking. But most of the public space is dedicated to the 15% of those who are in cars, and we need to improve the public transport system. And as it currently exists, people can drive into the central business district for free. You know, even people who take transit pay to take the train, but people who drive don't pay anything at all. And so we need to rebalance this, and it's going to make it better for drivers when we actually are being able to move some of those people onto public transit and expand our system. So it's a win-win-win, and we're looking forward to the implementation this summer.
Finally then, as our population grows and we design streets for the future, who should we have in mind?
I think there's no better frame than designing a street for kids, right? Having that perspective of a three-year-old. That totally changes how you look at the street. and, you know, making it safer for people to cross, making it more enjoyable for people to be around. I think that's the best lens for designing streets that work for everyone.
That's Janette Sadik Khan. She was in New Zealand this week for talks as a guest of the Helen Clark Foundation and the Urban Room.